Conservation Commission meeting is called to order, and tonight's meeting is being recorded for RCTV, and it's on, you can watch it on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33, and you could check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. So, on our agenda, we had the notice of intent for 218 Salem Street, and then at 7:05, we had an enforcement order for the same address, and the notice of intent, the publication, the notice of publication was sent to the Reading Chronicle. However, it did not get into the newspaper, so we really cannot discuss the notice of intent. And so they, Tom Hughes, the consultant, and the owners of the property decided not to come in tonight. The 710 ANRAD for 128 Eaton Street in Lakeview, map 7. We had a site visit last Tuesday. Chuck was there, Dave, Harry.
Mike.
No,
I was there.
Anika and Mike, and I attended. And we made some adjustments to the riverfront area as well as the flags for the wetland area. And we were looking for a revised plan. Bill Manuel, who is the consultant for the developer, said that he would try to get that in the next day on Wednesday, but that did not happen. So we don't have anything to discuss for that project tonight either. It would have been, we would have been reviewing the plans to make sure that what we had said in the field and the making the adjustments happened to that plan. So.
And there was a request for a continuance to the 14th.
From Mr. Manuel?
Yeah, from Bill Manuel.
Okay. So September 14th. Do we have a continuance? Well, we have a continuance for the notice of intent.
Yeah. Well, you don't need a continuance for the notice of intent. We didn't even open it.
All right. It's not 7:15.
So do we need to vote on the
on any of those? No.
Okay.
So our next.
Oh, you may want
to
vote
continue?
On. Sorry, the continuance of the ANRAD.
Make a motion to continue ANRAD 270-0666, Lakeview.
Second.
All those in favor? And 7:15, we have 17 Baker Road, but we can't discuss that until that time. Chuck, any old new business that we want to discuss?
Yes, we could sign the, well, we could discuss Galvin Circle and 648 Pearl Street, which was the request to
a
certificate of
compliance.
Yeah.
Dave Panette and I took a site visit last night, and we did observe two manhole, and I'm assuming the, I don't know if the rest of the commission had a chance to look at the plans, but they were very old, and they were hand-drawn, 1980. But from what I could gather, it was a connection from the drainage put in for Gavin Drive that goes underneath the lawn for 648 Pearl Street, and it goes underneath their driveway, and then it outlets through a culvert into a riprap channel that discharges actually into a vernal pool along Pearl Street. And this is the back of that violation that happened on Gavin Circle over the last couple of years.
Which way does it drain? Does it drain towards
towards
Gavin
Pearl.
Circle or
towards Pearl?
Towards
does
Pearl.
It go under Pearl?
No.
The culvert?
No, the culvert that we observed went under the driveway for 648.
And then it drains on in the vernal pool to the
right
of the house?
Yeah, and I'm assuming that it probably eventually does go underneath Pearl.
Yeah.
Okay. So, as far as we were concerned, that we thought it, you know, everything appeared to be correct, and I did see on the plan something to the effect of riprap. So, So, do I hear a motion to issue?
I so moved.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Okay, so I have that prepared. For your signatures. There was actually two other ones on that same address, but we found the certificate of compliance for those. She was very lucky.
So, can I, this is the same Gavin Circle that we've had issues finding the certificate of compliance before? Okay.
Yep.
So that, the...
This is actually the Pearl Street side, so...
Yes, this
right.
is a different side of it, but
right.
it's all, I mean, it was all that same development.
Right.
There was that last minute one that we had,
correct.
Where they were trying to close, and this was holding up the closing. Yeah.
And they would get in there and clean, they cleaned that up pretty well.
Yeah.
But they had taken those trees down out front without
yeah.
permission.
Yeah, just remember there was two, that so they had to have that closure, and then there was a certificate of compliance from when this was developed
right.
that never...
Right, we were talking about.
Chuck, do we have
and then
something for 285 and 281 Main Street? Gabriella?
Yes, 285, I provided the commission some information, a little background on the site work that was in question based on the last order of condition, and it appears that the town back in 2011, the commission only wanted to do a partial order of conditions because there was a couple of tanks found recently that needed to be removed or drained and filled in place. And I got, Geosite project, their project managers there, they had done the work, the site work, and provided some information and did a summary, which I sent out to the commission, on how they handled those two tanks. So with that, I prepared a certificate of compliance, and this will be a full certificate of compliance, and any issues on that site now we would address, because on our next order of conditions, which is for the current work that's actually going on out there, which is the building of the restaurant and the parking lot and the stream restoration project. So that's currently in effect, and we're about to close out the 2000, and I think this was 2005 when this was issued.
Aniga, did you have a chance to look at this? And this was these were the tanks where you had looked at the information our last meeting and found some reportable?
Yeah, admittedly, I didn't look too carefully. Unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to look too carefully at their letter. I apologize to the commissioners about that. But as we discussed, I think, at length at the last meeting, I had more than one conversation with DEP about the project, and I'm going to continue to watch it closely. I don't think this is the last time they're going to be before us. You know, they still have the final
mm-hmm.
certificate of compliance. They're not done establishing lawn or pavement or, you know, so... I don't, at this point, I don't have any objections going forward with, at least, are they requesting a certificate of compliance?
On this permit, on the old one, yes.
On the tank. I think that that's what I, so I don't object to that.
Okay.
I read the letter, I mean, somewhat in line with what we talked about last time, you know. We obviously saw something in the original report that stood out to us. You know, Anika had brought it to the attention of MassDEP, but I mean, other than that, I don't think there's any reason for us to hold up a certificate of compliance. I don't think they've done anything in regards to our permit or our notice, you know, the notice of intent that we issued that they haven't met, so.
Okay, any other comments from the commission members? Just for my interest, when did it change from Pizza World to Perfecto's Cafe?
Pizza World was on the other side.
Yeah, that property was never Pizza World. Pizza World would have been next to the Bank of America ATM.
Oh, okay, all right.
Drive-through.
Do I, motion to?
I make a motion to issue a certificate of compliance for 270-0540-281 Main Street.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Questions from the public?
No.
Sure.
Get that in the mail?
Yeah.
Me?
I didn't get my packet in the mail.
Did you
ask to not have any more
yes,
packets?
I did. Yeah.
No, I said I wanted mine.
Okay.
At the last meeting, I said I wanted.
So.
Even what you get in the mail is just the agenda. You don't get any of the plants.
Yep.
Am I not clicking on something?
No, the email you didn't. You wouldn't have got it. You just got a basic one.
Yeah.
They want to put.
Do we have time
okay.
for the extension?
Yes.
Yeah. What about the townwide public trails maintenance?
That's ready. So this is just a form to extend the permit that's still in effect. So there's no language on this, and I will reissue the town, reissue both halves of that, and with the changes that we discussed at the last meeting.
Okay.
You might have to approve that.
Approve that once you make the changes.
No.
Oh.
Did we? I don't know if the minutes, if we approved that
so
at the last.
Why don't I ask?
For a motion.
For a motion. Anybody make a motion to approve?
Are you asking for a motion?
I make
just
a motion
sign.
To approve the extension for the townwide public trails permit.
Second.
Is that for 5 years again?
Yes, to 2021.
Yeah, May 12th, 2021. All those in favor? Sorry.
And being 7:15?
No, I'm like at 7:14.
Oh. There's nothing else.
Did everyone sign in? There's a sign-in sheet in the back.
There is.
But, yeah.
Did you go and look at this?
Mr. Kouliad, where were you yesterday?
Be done by 8.
How's your wife doing?
It's crazy.
My wife's doing fine. My daughter and grandchild were with me for a couple weeks, and busy at work, and we got it. That's where I was. I was ready to shoot myself.
Did you forget again? Or?
No, I had intentions of coming, but last minute I just couldn't.
I get your phone number now.
That's all right.
Did I get get your phone number right, 603-560-4754.
Yes.
Okay. Say it louder into the microphone.
It's pretty well known in the community anyway, so I'm not really worried about the background.
Are you going to assemble those, Rebecca, and just email them out to all of us?
Yeah.
The numbers?
Yeah.
Okay. We still have a contact list kept by.
We do. I can, if I got those numbers, I could put them on the contact list and send it back out to everyone.
Okay.
Chuck, is that the letter for 115 Lakeview? Was that just put in for notification, or is that going to be part of the agenda tonight?
It's to discuss. It's part of the agenda. When, if you want, we can do that. I think we're within time for the next meeting, but
okay.
We can definitely discuss that. And I understand that you might have saw something very similar.
Yeah, I did.
At the last meeting, which in that letter would probably work out.
Yeah.
Okay, being 7:15, we have a request for determination of applicability for 2016-14, 17 Baker Road, map 34, lot 134, Raposa. And Mr. Raposa, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah, I'm Joe Raposa. I submitted an app, I think maybe you won't mind about, to just put an above ground pool into an existing frame that sits in my backyard. So it's a 17 wide by, I think it's 24 feet perhaps, well maybe 30 feet long. It's going to go on an existing bed of sand. There's pebbles there now. I was going to just put sand in to create a base. It's a rolled, it's not an in-ground pool, it's an above-ground structure. So I can fill up these forms here and bring it to you guys to talk to. I know that you guys came out last night to look at it.
Right.
It's pretty simple install. There's no ground construction that's required. It's just leveling it with sand is really the only treatment that needs to go on to the base. And it's a temporary structure that perhaps is going to live on for maybe 3 or 4 years, 5 years, and dispose of it. So there's a swing set in this place now. I put a picture into that back.
So Dave, Matt, and I took a site inspection last night, and what I couldn't tell from the plan, the colored up plan, was the location of the wetland in relationship to the downhill edge of that play lot, this wood. And so I had my tape measure, and there's their closest wetland to that structure is 26 feet. And then Mr. Raposa said that he was going to put the pool flush to the back part of the play structure, which also has some wood, and that would only be 17 feet. So there was it, and it didn't go to the very end of the wood. So we measured, and that was another six feet. So it was still 32 feet within that what we typically have a no structure zone. A little further on, however, and there was like a lump of wetland, and then it came back out, and it was an upland area. Still within the 35 feet in one location.
Refresh my memory. What is considered a structure? Because this is one that is.
We've read that a few times.
I don't, unfortunately.
Yeah. I think the opinion varies.
Yeah.
I think we took the dictionary and used that in the bylaw.
I think Anika has it. Originally, I thought it was permanent concrete underground structure, but I think if this is, and I think when we read it last time, that wasn't the case. I think I was a little off. There was, it included a couple more.
Yeah, something's clicking in my head that, Anika, maybe you can refresh my memory about.
I'll try.
Structure, when you have it in the ground, would affect the root system.
Yeah. Do we usually don't consider like a shed a structure?
Yeah, we do.
We do.
Yeah.
The only thing we haven't considered a structure is the riprap from an outfall. And that was allowed in the 35 and the 25 foot area in your project. Everything else from ever since I've been here, a structure in the dictionary says something like an assemblage of parts is a structure. Like a fence.
Right.
Like a sprinkler system, you know. A lot of towns get into this. I've heard the argument a bunch of times, but I think it's pretty clear here that you wouldn't allow anything. Even at 37 James Road, where all that fill was put in there, they needed a retaining wall. That retaining wall had to be on the 35-foot line, and there was a lot of reason to give a variance for that. That wasn't given.
Mr. Raposa, could you push back your structure any way or move it to the side?
Yeah, it would just require rubbing that wall down. That's heavy ledge in that area. I'm pretty certain some folks that have been to the building. So it would be a very significant. There is a shed right at my neighbor's lot line in the very back on the wetlands line. So I'm not sure. Which is 10, 15 feet beyond what I'm talking about here, so I'm not sure. And including an in-ground pool that's structurally, for sure, within the 35-foot mark. So, I mean, I was intending to crowd it to the very back of that small pad that I have intentionally in the first place, so that would help.
When you say crowd it, you say push it up towards this retaining wall.
Yeah, push it right to the very back.
And that's your backyard and the retaining wall?
It's towards the house.
Towards the house.
Yes, exactly.
So, Beck, you're saying the back of the sand, you think is 26, and then with the 17-foot pool, it gets into 32?
No, we measured from the retaining wall.
Oh, you measured from here?
Right, out for the dimension of the pool, and then from there to the wetlands. And it was.
And you came up about there, somewhere 30, around 32?
32.
32, yes.
I'm sorry. I'm visually missing this. Could you explain to me where the 32? Where you measure?
Well, do you see the retaining wall?
The edge, the edge of his pool out to a wetland line. I did two measurements from the edge of the low part of the wood structure.
Yep.
Out, that was 26 feet, and then he mentioned that the width of the pool was 17 feet. So that gave him. I was thinking, oh, it gives you some space, but it wasn't enough. It was only 6 feet.
Okay. Thank you.
I don't know if this helps at all.
So I'll go over that again. I don't know.
Sure.
Who put 60 on that plan?
I
did.
Is that 60 to the lot line?
That's to the lot line.
60 to the lot line.
It's not 60 to the wetlands.
Right. That's why I took the tape measure when
right,
I looked at the plan.
Right. Right. Because.
So from.
Yeah.
This edge to the wetland was 26 feet, and then from the edge of the pool to this wood structure was 6 feet, so six, and the 26 is 32 feet. But the thing is that the wetland did something like this, and then it went out. There was actually a tree out here. So
Rebecca, would you mind marking that up on the plan so
markers.
I can see it, just as an approximate wetland?
And I don't really know what happened up here. So this was the short area. So I was thinking if they could shorten it up or move it that way to get it out of the
How about, I wasn't on the site visit, how about the rest of the area of the yard? Were there any violations into the wetlands or anything, any filling or?
Well, there was grass, debris, yard debris in that shortened area of the wetland, and I think there were some twigs and things out there as well. Yeah, which we would really like, yeah, we'd like you to remove.
I have, it was a
I know that
horrendous dump site when I showed up here,
yeah.
So.
It's even worse on the home to the right.
Yeah, so I had cleaned up from my neighbor's lot where that shed is, in fact, a enormous amount of debris, concrete. They used this place, it looked like a landfill when I showed up. So I had cleaned, I've been cleaning it up over the years. As I get projects, whatever I use the dumpster to dump, I've taken truckloads to dump. And the last part is what I showed you.
Yeah.
To the end, and I've planted to the best of what I can some of the vegetation to grow in there, so it would kind of bring it back to the natural state.
Rebecca, does the wetland line get any further away from the house to the west?
That's what I was saying.
Yes.
It does. Okay.
Yes. It goes out. See how I've got it going down?
Yeah, correct.
Yeah.
Right. I'm just thinking between the end of that dash line and the yellow.
I don't know. I didn't go further, so.
Okay. But maybe topography.
Does not necessarily come back in?
I don't know. We didn't
okay.
Back out there.
Okay.
Is it?
Actually,
don't know.
That's a higher elevation. As you go towards this direction here.
You walked out back.
Yeah. The elevation is higher.
By how many feet, roughly?
Probably from the...
Couple feet?
There's a 12-inch drain tile that comes out where you see that finger to the left near the property line.
Right.
That's where the drain tile comes out. And it's probably 3.5 to 4.5 feet in elevation drop between where the drain tile comes out and where you see that little finger come towards his backyard. That little finger really doesn't exist.
Yeah.
It kind of goes straight there, the course of the water. But yeah, there's a significant increase as you go from where that little finger is, where that 60-foot line is. When you go from there towards the drain tile on the neighboring property, the elevation increases probably by at least, 3 to 3.5 feet.
So the proposed location here is essentially one of the lowest spots in the yard?
In his yard, yes.
Okay. So moving it a little bit more to the left
would probably bring it within.
Mean excavation.
Right. Would probably bring it closer to the 35-foot line,
I would say. Would you be amenable to moving it to the left?
Yeah, I've got a little room on the left because I'm only, and this isn't just, of course, this is my artwork, but moving that structure to the left, I think I have some room there
right.
For grass. I believe there's some grass there
yeah.
That I could go 4 feet, 5 feet, if that helps, and get it away from that little curl.
Yeah.
I think what I'd like to see is the pool out of the 35.
Hmm.
If we can sort of identify that wetland line in the back, and take a look at the layout of that pool, and if it can fit, then I can agree to that. Otherwise, we're talking about a variance, which means
variance.
A different filing, a more complicated filing, with different filing fees. And it gets a lot more complicated. And I see how you want to do this. And I want to see if it can happen with a little bit of adjustment.
Sure. So how do I determine that?
Well, you need to know the wetland line. And in the past, we've asked applicants to hire wetlands consultants to come out because they're professionals and they're working for you. You could take some of our opinions if you're willing to accept that.
I have a suggestion.
Go ahead. I want to hear how other people.
Great, but I want to suggest something before
yeah.
We get into what other people say. So that's why I'm
right.
Saying it now. So, Becky can flag well, and I know that, and it's half done. I don't know if you put a flag out there, but.
No, I did not.
It seems to be half done from what you're telling me. What did you do by plants or soil?
I looked at plants and you can actually feel, I didn't do any soil cores, but where we stepped, you could feel it go squishy.
Okay.
Very squishy.
So in the past, I have flagged wetlands on, you know, projects like this. I mean, maybe with us not verifying the wetlands, which is a possibility with requests for determinations, that we don't certify the wetlands. So if he ever does a bigger project, he would have to go back and do this. We can't use this wetland line.
Mm-hmm.
But I do think that if he can't end up moving it, he may have to get somebody in there to, you know, excavate, which is probably something he's not thinking of, and the money that's being saved by just me finishing off your line would make a big difference. So I don't have a problem doing that.
I was going to suggest that.
Okay.
Are other members of the commission amenable to that?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep. I guess I'm amenable to that, but I think if we're, you know, fairly close and it doesn't include excavation and he can get that pool into this corner up and over left as far as possible, and we're at, you know, pretty close, then it should be okay.
Up and over, you mean to where it
left?
Says 17 by 32?
Closest to the house and to the left.
We
measure closest to the house.
No.
Yeah, no. Chuck's going to do it. Yeah, right there.
Right.
So if we're
right
moving
there,
it like
the corner of the pool, in that corner, right there where the dotted lines are.
Yeah.
He's going to put it there.
So we just
no.
Want to be
well,
there.
I thought that sketch shows the pool. A few feet.
I understand,
out.
But not, Mr. Proposer, you'd be right up to the wood,
yeah,
right?
No, I'm talking about right up to the wood,
right
in this corner.
The
right.
Very far left corner of the existing structure
left
point is the corner of the pool.
Is that where you measured it at?
Yeah. There's not enough room.
Yeah, he's going to put that pool right up to that wood.
Right here, right?
No, up there. Can I have this one? He's going to put it up here.
Here's
and he's got some freeway. That's the 6 feet.
This existing
yeah, well,
structure
corner,
here.
The picture
existing.
That I'm seeing right here of this pool.
Pool would probably sit like this.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
That's probably where it's going with land.
That's what I'm talking about.
Which would be the furthest crowd to the wall and the furthest crowd to the left.
That's right.
So
okay.
It's only a 32-foot pool, and I think that is a 40-plus feet. So it would be 8 feet. I
all right. So you might be outside if you do that. Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, we just have to verify it.
I think we just need.
Could
yeah,
you? Would you
round.
Be amenable to going out and taking a look at that?
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. I
right.
would like to maybe have some flags where the pool's going, but that wasn't. With the pool flags weren't there.
Yeah, I can draw it. There's gravel. I could just strike it out so you know exactly what I'm going to put in the end.
Yeah, that would be helpful.
Yeah, because I'm going to flag the wetlands and then I'm going to measure up. I'm going to have to, if you're there, we'll have to make some adjustment until it works.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
All right.
Great.
Are there any questions from the public on this? Hearing none.
I move we continue this RDA to the next meeting.
Second.
All those in favor? And Chuck, you will get a hold of Mr.
Yeah,
Poser.
I called your
yeah.
phone. Oh, okay,
yeah,
that's the right number.
My kids play.
Okay.
Pokemon. I never seen my phone. So.
I didn't know it was
yes.
the right number
yes.
until you
okay.
said that. Okay.
All right.
Do
thank
any,
you.
Do you have any questions?
You.
No.
Okay.
No,
okay.
Thank
you.
You
made a second.
Yeah, Mike
second.
Seconded Anika.
Oh, so we did already.
Okay, it's time for the next item, which is a request for determination, 2016-15, 14 Covey Hill Road, map 38, lot 34, Silva. Mr. Silva.
How are you doing? Can I map it on the board so you can see it? Can I talk about it?
Hold on a second. Very sophisticated around here. I have this and I have this, so you tell me what works best for you.
I guess the one little sketch I made is probably easier.
That one there?
Oh, permission to erase it.
I don't know if I can turn around, Mike.
Yeah, that'd be great.
We can flip it.
Yeah.
Who control?
Mike.
Yeah, that's a good idea. Thank you, Anika.
Driving me nuts.
There you go. That's why you're sitting there, Mike.
Oh, you're on permission.
Side of me.
You probably have to be of service.
Boy.
Hey, I'm Emil, so I'm the contractor. I wonder if you move the existing deck and build a new deck in the same location. Right now it goes 8 feet short of the side of the house here and 2 feet short of the back. I just want to bring it to the side 8 feet so it's in line with the side of the house and 2 feet in line with the back of the house. And I want to be able to put the stairs instead of here and put them on the back here, 3 feet out this way. And dig some holes by hand. So pretty much just remove what's there and put a new deck in place, enlarging it to the same size of the house. But I know the concern was this area here being close.
Interesting.
Where's the wetlands?
Dave and I took an inspection, and I measured from your side, looking at the, I got the measurement tape again. I actually gave you 41 feet instead of 35.
I just kind of threw it a little bit. I couldn't get in there. I didn't know how.
From the existing, I had about 70. Yeah, you've got 82. I had about 76, but you're still
76 to the new deck.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's just the caution tape.
But I thought it actually was, it would be less than 76, because I had about 76 from the existing deck, which is a little bit further back than what you're proposing. But it's still quite a ways away from the wetland, and what it is a drainage ditch.
Okay.
And there are some, there's a bunch of twigs and branches probably 10 feet off of the drainage ditch in the back, a little bit to the left of the existing deck and the proposed deck, you know, straight back, that Dave and I observed, and we asked the owner if they would remove that. And that's something, you know, you can just take to the compost pile, and you're very close to the compost pile, actually, being off of Franklin Street. We did notice, however, that a family room, there were new posts, 7 of them, that looked brand new, and Dave said, when did that happen? And I guess that was put in this spring.
Mm-hmm.
Really?
We were talking to the owner, and she said that they received a building permit, but they never came before conservation, and they would have had to, obviously. You would have had to, because it's work within 100 feet of the resource area. So I believe tonight we would like to include those 7 pillars and the work that would be happening with the new deck as one project tonight.
So what, Chuck, how did Glenn issue without you signing off?
From what I heard, Glenn asked that conservation review it, but it still got issued, and I never reviewed it. And when they came in for this deck, there was someone else, Darlene was sitting, you know who these people are, Darlene was sitting there, and I think Kim wasn't around, and she said, hey, She put in the view permit. She asked me to review it, and it was clearly within 100 feet. And when I was talking to Mr. Silva, he told me about the other project, and so we discussed that a little bit. And it made sense to not only permit this at the same time as the after the fact work of the supports for that family room. So that's what we did.
So just slipped through with Glenn and Kim and.
Yeah, you know, it could have been a vacation thing.
Yeah,
I'm not,
yeah.
You know, I don't know what happened, but yeah, it wasn't reviewed.
Okay.
Sometimes the building department thinks it's ground disturbance. So unless the ground's being disturbed, they don't. You know, I've heard that before.
Well, that's ground disturbance.
Try to work on that each time. There is ground disturbance there, but so I don't know. Yeah, I have no explanation, but.
It looks like they're 70 or 80 feet away anyway, so it shouldn't be too much.
They are.
No harm, no foul, I think.
And it's pretty flat.
Yeah.
Very flat back there.
But I wouldn't say no harm, no foul. I mean, it's within our jurisdiction, and it wouldn't be a 100-foot buffer if it meant to be a 76-foot buffer.
Yeah, yeah, I get it, but I mean, nothing really.
No, no, this is a very friendly situation. We're just trying to get the paperwork in order and, you know, help these guys to get their project off the ground.
I apologize, I wasn't at the site visit, so I couldn't see the, I understand the deck. I may have a question about that, but the existing family room, what is it? You said seven pillars, so it's, this is a.
Seven nice posts within the footprint of that existing family room there. They're not outboard of that structure. They're there to support. I think there's two on the sides, and then the
I put four here, and then I got one in the middle here, so it supports the whole.
So what are they, precast concrete Bigfoots?
I pour the concrete, I get the Bigfoot in there, and I put concrete and rebar in there and put a little footing for each one.
So you put the plastic form for the Bigfoot, you didn't buy them from Shea?
No, I put the plastic
form. So you did it all by hand?
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you, so the one for the new deck, you will be?
Doing the same.
You'll be the same thing, we can do the same thing.
Okay.
I mentioned it to Charles too about doing helical piles. We would just put a screw into the ground where there'd be no dirt anywhere. Where we just screw a helical pile into the ground, it's all engineered and stacked out, saying how far it goes down. And you'd have a little bit of dirt coming up out of the ground, almost like an ice cream cone. So that would involve any digging.
Yeah,
so.
Definitely less disturbance. So
that's
sonotubes or helical piles could be written into this order, and both would be allowed. I think it's up to the contractor.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I was talking about, Chuck, to get off subject. I'm sorry. That's what I was talking about for the Boy Scout pass, where they have to put decking through the marsh or swamp.
Yep.
Those drill bit like things.
What are they called again?
Helical pile.
Yeah.
Mike, you know what they are, right?
Yeah.
And they're not expensive.
They take a machine to put them in.
I think you can log some of those by hand, right?
There's a company that puts them out. They come down. It's like probably $100 a piece to put each one in.
And they use it like an auger. It's a couple of guys holding an auger.
It's like one guy in the machine. It actually fits into a house or a basement.
Yeah.
About 3 feet up behind, it's like a little machine. He walks in. It's all got gauges on it, compressors on it. So you put a screw with the foot with the post, which is metal, and it gets screwed into the ground.
So that gives you the hole instead of hand digging it or using a bobcat.
Right.
And
there's no digging
is your foot in it.
You actually don't even dig a hole. You just go from just right in the ground, you just screw it in.
Yeah.
Ah, okay.
It's a giant screw.
This goes to refuse.
And so the plates do the same thing that the
only problem is, either it hits a refusal or a big bowl.
Well, you can have issues, but it's just like digging
issues,
a fence post.
In this case, a hand dug Bigfoot is probably just as effective.
Yeah.
Rebecca, could you speak to the nature of the drainage ditch? Is it got some good vegetation? Is it?
It's pretty deep. The sides are fairly deep.
It's probably, in some places it's 3 feet wide, some places it's 6 feet wide. It's 3 feet deep.
Yeah.
Sand in the base of it. There's not much vegetation around it because
it's all
trees around it.
Okay, does the lawn just go right up to it?
Lawn goes within probably 15 feet of the ditch on the back, and along the side it's probably within 8 feet.
Yeah.
Along the driveway.
This asphalt in the driveway and.
Okay.
And it's treed. Mature trees, there's a natural vegetation.
Mm-hmm.
So there is some buffer existing along the whole drainage ditch.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's helpful.
Even on the side of the house, yep.
I'm glad to hear that.
Are there any questions from?
I guess I have one other question.
Yeah.
Any evidence of yard fill?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
I just mentioned.
You said okay, but I thought you said it was close to the house.
It's close to the drainage ditch in the back.
Okay. Okay.
So it's between the edge of the formal lawn and the edge of the drainage ditch.
Okay.
In
so
the woods, in the treed area.
And it's about 6 feet wide by, you know, 3, 4, 5, and, you know, maybe that high.
We wouldn't, I'm just bring it up, pulling a Jamie here. We wouldn't consider this a perennial stream, would we? No.
I don't know.
Was it dry when you were out there?
It was dry. There wasn't a lot of bit of water in it. No.
Okay.
Then we wouldn't.
It looks like a runoff drainage ditch to me.
But the Ipswich River going under Mill Street is dry.
Well, it's an unusual year, but.
No, that's true.
Yeah, it's bad.
Well, that's not the greatest area to check out.
Do you?
And does that, if it doesn't have a name? I'm not saying that.
I can't tell from this USGS either.
I don't think, for this amount of work, I don't know, we need to get into whether that's a river or.
No, I just think for it, my interest is just for the sake of kind of nailing down for our knowledge where the perennial streams are in town. It's just, you know, sort of like knowing our own backyard.
Do you have a USGS?
No.
Here's the drainage ditch comes from.
I can see him working.
I don't know.
I can see.
Two streets over, there's a wetland area.
I can find the U on here.
Up on Nathan Road, in a net lane.
Where is this?
So this is a request for determination, right?
Mm-hmm.
Correct.
And it's the scope of work is limited to deck rebuild.
Let's approve this thing and move on.
One second, I guess it's up now.
You mean give it a negative, you mean?
Yes.
Yes. I'm just curious,
that's all. Becomes, can you move that map to the, you can see it comes from that behind it.
Oh, it's a blue one.
There's a little, that green area there.
You got
that drainage ditch actually
Franklin
comes out of
Street.
That.
Yeah, it's Franklin.
Yeah, it's above Franklin.
Yeah.
So I'll zoom in close. I wouldn't, on first blush.
Yeah, be willing to bet it's
I wouldn't
it's
think
not.
That was. I wouldn't even.
No,
I mean we've checked on other roads around here and Fourth Street a lot, and this is going to run into Fourth Street, and it's not even down here a perennial stream.
Okay.
So this is further up and a little bit more chopped up.
So this is land subject to flooding.
Probably.
Wetland.
This is a little bit sketchy. Just jumping.
Okay, I just wanted to ask.
We could do run stream stats on it, but maybe not at the meeting.
It doesn't look it doesn't to me, based on our experience over on Arcadia, I would be tempted to say it's not worth the calculation.
Yeah,
the basin.
But Arcadia is basically downstream of the entire, the whole town kind of drains out and down.
Right.
So when we're looking at properties down around the bottom, down by 128 and 93, it's going to have a lot more drainage area.
Right.
There's not much up here because.
Right.
Wait, Chuck, do you have this on? Do you have it up there? Am I looking at it? Where is it?
Right there. It's not coming up. 14 Covey must be right here.
It's 38-43.
It's that one,
it's 38-43.
Yeah.
Coming up.
But that blue
this
line
is it right here.
That blue line is not a
perennial stream.
No.
River necessarily. It's
okay.
It says easy.
Ditch. Okay. All right.
No, I'm satisfied.
I'm trying to figure out where all this water comes from. And there's a house on Martin Road that basically has a backyard that looks like a swamp.
Well, that
seems to be where the water comes from.
Well, frankly, if you look at the other side of Franklin Street, where the golf course is sloping in the other direction, and the road, Grove Street, goes down.
Mm-hmm.
There's no source of meaningful water for that to feed into.
It's very wet in this area here. And it's really wet in that area, and all the way through here. So, I get a lot of calls around here about that and about that culvert. So if that culvert blocks up, backs up all the way through there. So
there's a large wetland there to the.
Yeah, this is huge. Mm-hmm. So you can see some of the wetland if I turn this on and it works.
I think that whole pool.
Ooh.
Or not. Let's turn that back off again.
Okay. I think that whole golf course pool is surrounded by wetlands. Yep. No, I'm satisfied.
Mm-hmm. Are there any questions from other members? Are there questions from the audience?
So this would approve either hand drilling or that
helical pile. Yeah.
Yeah. This approval goes for either, and Manny and I can just figure out what.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And I have one condition that the yard waste will be removed. Manny told me that he's going to be taking any of the spoils from the digging off-site. And I don't think this needs erosion control.
Okay.
Okay.
Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion for a negative determination for RDA 2016-15, 14 Covey Hill, is that the right one? Yes, Covey Hill Road.
I'll second.
Hold on.
I'll just say, as amended with the yard waste and spoils being taken off site.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.
So I have that prepared. They'll sign it tonight. You can pick it up tomorrow if you want.
Okay.
But we already discussed when you can start. So.
Okay, so just pick up information at town. And
that's really all you have to do. And
okay.
Then when you get ready to go, I need you to call me. So I can either send it to you or you can pick it up. If you're not going to start immediately, you can.
Yeah, I just thought we'll get some more facts on some material and all that. And then once they want to.
It'll be ready tomorrow after 10 o'clock.
Okay. And the drawing I have here, I can submit that to like Glenn. So we're going to be talking to you.
Yeah, I'll let him know in the morning.
Okay, great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. Do we have an update on the tree policy?
I have not.
Okay.
Can I make a can I make a suggestion about that? They're actually the MAC actually has their fall training this fall is for trees and tree removal and tree policy. Possibly maybe hold off on the Reading Conservation Commission tree policy and maybe send a couple of people to that training, see what they say.
When is that? Do you remember?
I think it's in
Hawaii. I have the flyer right here. It's October 29th.
Where is it?
Holyoke.
Just a suggestion.
Yeah. Where in Holyoke? UMass?
It's at Holyoke Community College.
What's the cost for the training?
It's $95 for MACBC members and and a little bit more for if you're not a non-member.
And we have a continuation of Mariana Drive.
Are we holding off on the tree policy now? Or
yeah, we don't have any.
No, I mean holding off like it was suggested by Dave till someone goes to this conference.
What was the last conversation about? I thought it was just about done, wasn't it?
Yes.
The last conversation.
It was done.
The last conversation.
DOA.
Yeah. Harry was going to revise.
You know what I propose? Well, I think that's a good idea. I think what we concluded was a very, very simple policy. So let me wrap that up. We'll get something published, and then we can go to the training, and if we need to change it,
I actually talked to two people that were on two other conservation commissions, and they told me they didn't have a policy either. And they said, you know, we probably really should. So, you know, I was just thinking, if you have this resource here, and I was reaching out to these people just to get what their policy was and perhaps use that as a template. And then I thought, well, you have this organization that is for Massachusetts Conservation Commissions. Why reinvent the wheel? And maybe you'll have something that's in parity with other communities.
Not a bad idea.
So I don't disagree with that, but I think we're so close on the first one. I have my notes.
I don't disagree with you.
The only thing I would say, Harry, and I think it's great that we've gone through this process to think about it. In essence, we've become, I think just in the last 6 months, a lot more consistent on how we treat applications that come in for this policy. So I think we've already made the first good step.
Yep.
Whether that the policy's in a final draft form or not, I think, you know, it could always use some edits if we see something else. But I think right now we're consistently, you know, the big thing when this came up was we didn't have a consistent basis of how we were judging tree removals and projects. And we've really, I think, taken some good steps to change that. So
even this policy, I think, is a living document.
Yeah,
it contains a full document, so it's not like it's etched in stone.
Right.
Pretty proud of it, though.
No, I think it's good. I think it's a good policy.
You should be proud.
But that policy is going to get amended because it allowed work. We're not. It allowed work by right, and that's not going to. That's what we discussed. These things. It should be more of what to expect when you're taking down a tree, rather than in these areas you can just go ahead and take down a tree. So that's the change we were going to make.
Yeah, I think I was here for that. I think I remember that.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay.
All right. So I'll take another crack at it.
If you want, you can send it to me, and then we can hash it out a little bit and then send it to the commission.
We have a report on Pinevale. Anika and Chuck took a look at the area today. We tried to find, but it was off of Riverside Drive.
I had forgotten.
It's just in back of 17 and 13 Riverside Drive, and there's a drainage ditch that receives stormwater runoff all the way from West Street, and it doesn't capture every single street. But it's pretty big, and from what I hear, it's a 30-inch pipe. So there's a lot of sand built up, maybe 3 foot in some areas, and maybe a foot.
Did you see this?
No,
six
I'd like
inches
to
as you get further.
Actually,
further
talked to
away.
Ryan about this week.
So the DPW alerted me to this. And when I saw all that sand, the sand can't be there, according to, you know, the Conservation Commission, and the sand also can't be there, according to the DPW department, because it's causing serious problems, because there's a drainage, a sewer drain that goes over it, and when the sand builds up, instead of going underneath it, it goes on top of it. And it creates a distilling basin in back of it, and it causes a whole bunch of scouring on either side. And I think we saw some of that today. And it's kind of widening out that whole area, and it's, you know, it's really becoming a problem. So in the past, the DPW department got in there when they had a bigger crew, a larger amount of employees, and they would clean this twice a year, from what I heard, every 6 months they would, but they had more people back then. To me, it looks like
it's been cleaned in years.
It hasn't been cleaned in years. The trees are reestablished, maybe 10 plus years, maybe 15 years, something like that. But luckily, there's still access there. There's some vegetation, but it's not woody. You can get all the way up to where this disposal needs to happen, and the spoils can be picked up, and we can clean out this area. This sounds like an area that may that has become a huge problem right now, but in the future could probably be maintained a lot easier with smaller equipment. They do have a tiny little, I'm gonna call it a backhoe, but I call everything a backhoe. that looks like a bobcat. They said it's about the size of a bobcat. And I think I sent it out to you guys. I saw a picture, I thought, of it. And they have this piece of equipment where they can get in and do this clean out. And so we talked a little bit about it, and the way I would like to go is with, you know, you guys discussed this, but I want to issue an enforcement order for the DPW department, requiring them to remove the siltation from the stream. And by doing that, we can allow it to happen with conditions, and we can have it happen right away. So this is a pretty bad problem. They want to have it done within the next 2 weeks. So they anticipate you know, weather coming in over the weekend and in the future. And it's something that I wanted to bring the commission out to see, but you know, that's pretty much the, you know, my reasonings for why we should do this, why we should move forward, and why it's an enforcement order. The DPW department said that they would provide mitigation for the commission, and I suggested removing a pile of yard waste, which was right around the corner, which is probably 15 feet long and 6 feet high or something like that.
Whose yard waste is it?
It's on Pinevale land. It is the neighbors, but it's a situation where, if you want to just talk about that yard waste, where I can't get one single person to remove it because it's historic and so many people have added to it. It doesn't make any sense to find one house and say you need to take care of this. But when it's gone, I mean, I tell you, I'll do my best to protect that, including putting up some surveillance if the commission would allow me to do that. But we would protect it because
spy on everybody.
Well,
I
think this is a neighborhood that
we have
a neighbor there, but
we had a neighbor there who was,
I'm not sure.
Would we need permission from that property owner?
It's on our land. It's on town.
It's on town property.
Yeah.
Oh,
it's conservation land.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So you're saying a bunch of abutting neighbors have contributed to this?
Yeah,
yes.
It must be.
You
it's
can't
too,
attribute
too
it to
big.
Just
yeah.
one person.
It's enormous.
Oh, I get you.
So we could get that out of there and then watch it. You know, a lot.
Well, we could get it out of there, and we could send a letter saying that it's been
letter,
removed
yeah.
by the town, and if it's replenished, you'll be fine.
Well, we have to catch who's doing that, and I think the police department have surveillance cameras
that we can
get, or we can rent, and we can just put them out there.
But it's good.
He's serious. It's good.
But it's good to remind people once it has been removed.
Yeah, I am serious. This is mitigation that we could have used elsewhere in town.
Put some signs up there too.
And for other uses. And what we're doing is cleaning up someone else's problem. So I don't
right.
want it to come back.
Right.
I mean, mitigation we can use to do anything we want.
So how many parcels abut this town land?
Let me pull it up on the screen.
Pile is?
I mean, the last time I have an email from
it
you
works.
About this parcel, Chuck, it was from October 2013.
I mean, rather than using the mitigation, if there's, you know,
and that was for that
six
property.
Parcels that are there, why don't we contact them and have them share equally in the cleanup?
Because
well,
we have to show that they've
no, well,
letters went
let's
out
ask
to
them.
The residents at the time back
when?
In the
what?
Fall of 2013.
Fall in 2013.
And we did two site visits to the neighbor who was clearly closest to the area access area. His property was the access area. And he kind of said, I didn't do it. Make me.
So this is it's in the
so
center of this circle
this
right
is
here.
The same location, huh?
Right.
Where is Pineville?
Do
you know where Sunnyside is?
I mean, I would assume that it's
Pinevale Ave.
We're kind of in this area here
with
who's doing it.
It's
access.
It's,
which one of these streets is Pinevale?
Pineville is the.
You know where the Starbucks is? If you go to the road, go down
past
the road just before it. Let me, we'll get there. Hold on a second. I'll back out.
Oh, yeah, I know where you are. Yeah, it's 28.
Oh, okay.
It's all kinds of deer in
there. Yeah,
right?
I can't.
There
this is acting up.
Right here.
Right there.
Yeah. There's
so,
access there.
So this is near that maple, that corner of Maple and where we've had
yes,
this conversation
yes,
before.
Yes, 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 yeah.
All right.
This is also Minot Street here, and you have access down Center and Park and Warren.
Well, so that's what I thought, we had thought, and I think that's what you just circled, that it was the access from this corner at Center and Maple that was.
Where was that guy?
Out.
Has he been back before us?
No, but he was outside last night. We went by.
Is there still a hole in the ground?
So I was going to go in Maple, and I said, no, I'm not going in there. So I went up to Pineville.
Was there still a hole in the ground?
I didn't.
She didn't go by.
He was in the driveway.
Well, I've been past that house. The fence section is up. I don't know if it comes down in the fall. Are we talking about the same thing?
No, the deck.
Maple.
Oh.
There was a deck that had.
He had dug
it.
I don't know. I haven't heard anything about that deck, but he did get a permit for some siding and some other things. I didn't check out that whole. We didn't get over there today, so.
Well, it's not on.
It's not before us.
So where are all the abutters that? Where's the dumping?
I would assume that it would be walking distance to this entrance, and that would be all these. I would assume it's an easy, run with stuff down.
So that's Maple Street, so, right?
It's Maple and Center.
Yeah.
This is acting up, so I can't really.
So that's where you're going to have the debris removed.
There's a good pile here.
Actually, Chuck, hold on. You're talking about. This is Pinevale.
No, Pinevale is down here.
Yes,
I know,
correct.
But the place where we saw.
That's where the culvert is.
This is where that stream culvert is that we were just talking about from the DPW. It's right
yeah.
here. So I thought we were talking about the dumping here.
Well, as you can see, there's no access.
Oh, okay. So you're
but
talking about
there is
about
another
over here.
Pile
you're talking
right
about
there.
That one.
All
right.
This.
Yeah, we saw that, Anika, when we were out today.
Yeah.
Where, okay.
Where is all the dumping grounds?
Anika, when you guys sent a letter in 2013,
yep.
Where did you, what abutters
streets,
did you send it?
Everyone,
which streets?
Everyone that abutted Pineville.
Everyone?
Yeah.
Ah.
Dumping letter.
But majority, though.
It was Maple Street, Center Ave, Park, Riverside.
No.
Or is it up in here?
That's a lot of people. It's probably 30, 40 people.
I mean, read the Chronicles review on this. The gentleman that wrote that tells you everything that's wrong about Pineville.
Is it the area that he was talking about?
And we have here.
Yeah.
That was the place.
That was the one.
This is the one we have access to.
Right, but that wasn't that the one
that was the
that was the one we were
30,
talking about,
like the
yeah.
10 foot by 30
and
by.
We got the you got the pushback from
right.
Yeah.
That
yes.
is the one we
that
got pushback from.
There was a letter.
Yeah.
There was a pushback
letter.
Right.
What you guys don't know
yeah.
is this is a fence. There's obviously a rivalry. It's like the Hatfields or McCoys, and these guys said that they could do a better leaf pile than these guys. So what's happening here is a little neighborhood competition.
So can we get both of those piles removed as mitigation?
We can't get there.
We can't get to the
you
other
can't
one.
Get
it's
to
an
that
access
one.
Issue.
And we absolutely can't get to there because it was brought up and the engineering department said that they would consider it, but then they need to access it through someone else's lawn and there would be repairs and there would be damped.
Wait a minute. What about the resident, Chuck, the cooperative resident who lived...
Don't worry.
The cooperative resident who was closer to that bigger pile.
You can't give up the informants.
It's still damaged.
It's how you lose
the lawn and all
wow.
that.
Okay.
So
we did find an informant on our site visit.
I don't, I think that that could be addressed in the future if,
right.
if, you know, we have to see how this is, how
I think
this works out.
There's no better way to highlight that now is the time that we're not going to allow any more of this to occur than right after we get rid of it. Right after we get rid of a large pile.
Makes sense. I mean, it's going to be on your site visit list for, you know, the next.
Well, if DPW or engineering are getting some stuff removed, they might be able to also move some big boulders there that make it pretty challenging for people to drag large tarps full of stuff into that area.
Other than you can't get in the one that's in this corner.
Right.
They have plenty of, the way that one works out there is there's probably always going to be access because it's right next to someone. It's kind of right on the edge
of someone's
yard. The path is right there.
Yeah.
That gentleman on number 2 Maple Street has actually taken over town property, and we're going to have that surveyed coming up, and we're going to get that back as part of this project. And then they're going to then need access to get in there. They actually have to be on town land. So that's the only way it works. There's probably other piles throughout there, but they might not be easy as this one is to get. And I've had some other ones in the past removed from the DPW. DPW department has moved some stuff for me. What's going on here?
Yeah, I tried to
down
hike
in
Pine
area.
Vale once, but it was such a wet land.
I didn't even know
that existed. I didn't have a problem.
I tried, well, maybe it was my access point.
Chuck, maybe when one of the Boy Scout troops want to do a project, if we could get permission from those people in the corner to let Boy Scouts in there and remove that by hand without giving them a violation. Just say, you know, you're doing a good deed, you're helping the Boy Scouts, we're going to get rid of that pile, and by the way, don't put it back, or next time you're going to get a fine. Do they come in and ask you what's a good idea for the project, or they just come and present the project?
Electrify it.
It's not really a building project.
Being a Boy Scout, or used to be, and going through that with my son, that's not a typical Boy Scout project. There's a couple things. Usually you don't ask kids to clean up trash because there's issues involved with that, with what they might find. It has come in where someone's asked me if they could go ahead and do it, but it's through you know, with a leader and whatnot. But we don't go in the opposite direction and ask them to clean up trash. Secondly, that is a dense pile, and I'm not kidding you. The one in that corner is 15 by 9 feet. It would take several years for them to do it that way.
It's dump trucks.
Have we talked to the Trails Committee about this?
Well, we talked to them last week, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think that one's there to stay. I think that's just, you know, if they wanted, I can't see a way that, I mean, the way I've kind of figured this out was to remove it in the first place and then watch for those small piles to reappear. I don't think that we're getting everything out in this area that I've located. There's still going to be small piles out there, and there might be some opportunity for scouts. But I think the commission needs to reach out to scouts, because a lot of times they're actually going to the Town Forest Committee and the Trails Committee, and they have so many projects that we're not hearing from them except for approvals. So if anyone has any contacts with the scouts, that would be, you know, a great idea. And I'm not saying that, hey, scouts, we want you for cleanups. We have other projects. I mean, you know, we have signage that needs to be redone. We have a material cabin that needs work. You know, we could have some new trails made. We could have some steps on some trails made, so where to end some erosion problems that I know about. There's definitely a short list, and there's some boardwalks that need to be built, which are tougher because they're pretty long, and you know, scouts only need to do a certain amount, or can do a certain amount. So it would be a multiple scout project, but there is some smaller stuff also.
As it relates to Pine Vale, I drove by there, and I didn't go in, but where there was a washing machine out by the road, I don't know if that has been there, but on Pine Vale at that entrance.
Which entrance?
Pine Vale.
The one off of Pine Vale.
Oh, the Pine Vale entrance.
And there's a washing machine.
It's still there now?
It was there
yesterday. And right up past, going in that accessway along that, that 11-214 on that bank and on that right-of-way, there is some yard waste, yard debris that's been placed down over the bank there.
So just to finish the thought, it wouldn't be, it doesn't look inviting. It looks a little scary because it's, the path is closed in with vegetation.
Yeah, it is very, yeah.
It feels...
Japanese knotweed.
It feels a little threatening. And I think when you have a situation like that, it discourages people from going in and walking around in there, which means people don't notice what's going on in there.
Let's not blame ourselves for this.
No, all I'm saying is if we can, is that may be an area
so
where...
So
just finish the sentence, Chuck. If you know, if we're looking for a project for scouts or whatever, making that an inviting entrance, putting up the signs that look pretty tired, stuff like that, that's the kind of thing, if you have a bunch of the neighbors going in and walking around and seeing what it looks like from the inside, they're more likely to hold each other accountable. And to get more traffic, more foot traffic in there, get people enjoying it.
It's actually, apart from the vegetation going in, it's actually blazed well. There's a blue trail and there's a white trail, and it's well marked.
That's not the issue. I'm just saying when you drive by, right, when you pull up to that entrance,
mm-hmm.
signs look old, there's a washing machine, it's closed in. It's a little scary.
I get that, but there are a lot of, I mean, if you're going to say that about Pineville, you got to say that about Higgins. You got to say that about a lot of those signs at the entrances. In a lot of cases, are looking pretty tired and old.
Yeah, I just think that would make a big difference to people's taking responsibility for
bodies. I actually teed this up and forgot to put it on for the Pineville discussion. Here's Pineville, 17 acres, and it gives you all the projects that were done, 2013, 2014, 2014. There's been a lot of work there. And I did talk to some of the Trails Committee, and they say after that article was written, what they felt the problem was is it's not as well used as the town forest or Kirchian Woods. And it's, you know, if people aren't using it, it does start to look that. There's a certain amount of foot traffic that needs to happen for the trails to be maintained. You know, as far as the washing machine goes, I'm surprised someone would put that up with that in the neighborhood and they wouldn't have made a call. There's an app? I don't know if it's an app, but the Click It Ticket, they have that on the town website, and if you see something wrong in town, you can identify it and give the address and sends an email to the DPW department, and you know, something like that can't stay, and I'm sure it has to go, and they would take care of it. But that's one thing. But as you can see, there has been work recently in Pineville. And if we had a bunch of scouts coming in all the time, I guess that we could have the luxury of picking and choosing what jobs and projects they could work on. I actually walked in Pinevale a lot during my little 5-foot challenge, and I kind of like it. I mean, I guess you, in some spots you're almost in someone else's backyard, but it's pretty dense. And it's pretty interesting because it's a winding trail and it has a pretty nice boardwalk in it. And then you can get from one end to the other pretty quickly on a halfway decent trail and actually, you know, walk around it. And there's wildlife out there. I think I saw a raccoon today in the stream. And there's deer and there's probably coyote. Well, what else would be out there? You know, it's an interesting piece. It just needs to be used a little bit more, and you know, the Trails Committee isn't that big, So maybe this could be something that the commission could, you know, also take on and.
Well, I had volunteered.
You volunteered for this?
I kind of.
So this is.
So I would like to talk to the Trails Committee about that.
Okay.
It's not that far from my house.
So to circle back to our project.
And let's just write an enforcement order and have them clean it up. You told them that's the way you want to handle it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that sounds, I don't know about you guys, but that sounds like the right way to go to me. Yeah.
Do we need a motion?
Yeah, you'd have to make a motion to issue an enforcement order to the DPW department to clean the fill in the drainage ditch located just in back of 17, is it?
Riverside Drive.
Riverside Drive, yeah.
Do we need to vote over our mitigation as well?
And then what the mitigation is would be good.
Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
You want to add the yard waste? So, and remove the yard waste at the corner of 2 Maple and Center.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Can I ask a question? Just a brief discussion before we do that. So once this enforcement order is established, a couple things I noticed out there was, what are they going to do with that sand? Are we going to get to those details at the next meeting?
I
thought if they could remove it, they might sidecast it.
Yeah, let's talk about that right now.
I'm not opposed to sidecasting, especially because if you could tell from the photos, there is one particular scour part next to the concrete bridge is what I'll call it, the sewer, the covered concrete bridge, concrete covered sewer bridge. There's a significant amount of sand out there, and if they are going to side cast it, some level of bank stabilization needs to happen. Otherwise, it's just going to be sand remobilized in the
next
flood.
Want to be side cast?
Let me make it clear that this DPW knows about this from the very start, and I've walked through what we want to do, what they want to do, so they understand how this process has to happen. I talked to Ryan about side casting the spoils, and that we would require some jute netting around that to keep it in place. Some voluntary vegetation, you know, grows in later on, but certainly when it starts to rain and it fills up again, we don't want to wash it downstream and create that work again. But before he does that, before that happens, he is going to look and see if he can remove it and to see what that will take. But bringing in trucks back and forth is going to create more damage.
How many truckloads are we estimating, Chuck?
Lot of sand.
One dump truck.
Probably not too good at that,
yards.
I would think one. Like one of their biggest
dump
trucks.
3 feet
by
what?
Sand.
I mean,
how about, let me put it this way, not more than one.
Not more than one dump truck.
Yeah.
So how many yards does a dump truck take?
It's 10
cubic yards. 10 cubic yards.
So it's like, it's on average, it's about a foot, and it's about 150 feet long and about 6 foot wide.
That's a good
900 cubic feet. That's a lot.
Yeah, that's a lot.
Yeah,
that's more than 10 cubic yards.
Yeah.
So
probably three truck. That's three 10 wheelers.
In
the past,
40 cubic feet.
Three 10 wheelers.
Is it really?
Four.
Exactly.
In the past, they've just cast it on the side, and this, you know, the banks are expanding. There's a tree undercut.
I would also like to know, I mean, what's their plan? How low are they going to go upstream? How low are they going to go downstream? You know, we had that 65 feet reach downstream that you and I approximated.
Mm-hmm.
But they might, you know, I guess some sense of, you know, how much they're going to excavate
I don't think
in there.
I don't think it's them. I think we should tell them
how far and how deep to go. Chuck, we should coordinate that through Chuck, right? Because you're probably on site when this happens, right?
I'm on site when it happens.
Yeah.
And I think that they would go downstream as far as they could without damaging the bank.
Right.
Because they
I
could
mean,
keep
where they're
going.
Choosing this, it's wide enough just to get in and work.
Yeah.
And both sides. But as soon as it starts pinching off, I don't, you
so
know,
that,
I'm not
that
allow
Jeep,
any
that
bank.
Jeep Mac is expensive, so I imagine Ryan and the DPW would much rather get rid of it than sidecast it and jute mat it and maintain it after that. They'd probably want to get it out of there, be their best
option.
It's
sand.
The sand is not ideal to sidecast. I mean,
yeah,
it's just gonna
flow again.
Slough and lose. I mean, this is the reason it's down in there is because this is
silt.
The prime type of stuff to
right.
slough and just start
well,
floating away.
Let me just, on a positive note, say this is the time of year to do this work. It's pretty dry. You know, vegetation's starting to turn hybrid, go into fall.
Chuck, what would be the
dormancy.
Chances of... I guess you'll have to talk about this with Ryan, but what would be the chances of removing it and then bringing in a couple of truckloads of organic material?
That would be great, but that would be the mitigation.
Maybe would allow him to do that without the jute mat, get him off the... If he put
no,
some
you
organic
have,
material
have to
in
mat
there
no
and planted
what.
It, I think
you'd,
at this time of year, that'd...
You'd have... So we use this thing called core logs. You're really looking at jute, I mean, your stream restoration, jute mat, core logs, staked in, and then, I don't know, willow
vegetation.
Just the
plugs.
Thin plastic with a little hay in it.
So you're...
That's what you're talking about.
No, the core logs.
What we did on the sewer extension.
Mulch logs.
When George crossed the stream and he had to plant
right.
on both sides.
Right.
That,
no,
that
wasn't
material.
That wasn't core logs.
What was that?
That was just...
mulch sock.
Yeah, some sort of sock.
No. He had some plantings on the bank, and he had a few rolls.
Oh no, that's not a log. That would be a mat. That's
right.
That was a,
what
that
kind
was like
of
a
mat was that? Do you know? That was a hay.
That was just hay mat.
That looked like an inexpensive mat.
Yeah.
That's cheaper than the jute mat.
That would be fine, but I don't.
You don't know.
You know, this
do
is
it.
In a stream, so you need that. You need that protection from the scouring. So
right now
that's not going to hold up.
Right now the stream banks and a couple of scour places are kind of vertical stream banks.
Oh, really?
You know, and so you don't, I mean, what kind of slope are they going to make
asking,
after that?
It sounds
that
like we're asking to reconstruct a bank.
Well, well,
or
I think if he had to bring in the bank, like you're saying, and repair it, you know, you're not going to do half the work. You would really need to...
Yeah.
Do it better, and they might not be qualified. They might feel like they're not qualified to do that.
We might feel like they're not qualified to do that at some point.
Yeah, Mike's saying we're not. We might feel like they're not qualified to do that. I mean, there's a lot to it. I mean, that has to be done right. And
so, are we saying to do that? Bring in?
No, I don't.
Not yet.
I think there's a couple. Well, just remember that this historically had to be cleaned twice a year. Okay, so something's getting in
under,
there.
Under an order that we gave DPW, not this commission, but a previous commission gave DPW an order that still stands?
I don't know about that, but I don't know if there was ever an order of conditions. There's been several administrators here, and there was a policy to have what I thought was the highway team would go down all these streams and make sure that they weren't obstructions in them.
Do you have a document? Do you have anything? Just a policy. Someone just did it. Just what
this
we
isn't
always
an
did.
Ongoing.
This is well. There's a point where in the 70s it was considered maintenance. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
And as we got to
then
our own bylaw in the late 80s, we it became an issue.
Right.
I mean,
so
the town is historically really backed up on decades.
Yeah,
maybe backed
out,
up.
Yeah, they ran
on
out of money.
On
and also
cleaning
we lost
streams.
A lot of DPW
personnel.
Workers, so it was kind of like. Conservation probably pushed back a little bit, but they actually didn't have the manpower anyways, and you know, and then now we have these problems that have to be resolved with, a real notice of intent and mitigation, and what you're talking about is very expensive.
All right, so let's go back to what we need to give Ryan and DPW direction.
Well, I think at this point we need to find out how far he's going. agree that he won't be cutting into any bank to get to the next area. And whatever he can get with that machine is fine, and he needs to only bring it down to the duff lair. And
no side casting, well, he's gotta get it out of there.
Well, we're gonna find out if he needs to side cast it.
I don't think that's a good idea. Mike's absolutely right.
Yeah,
well,
it's gonna come back.
Even let me
the,
just say that if they
the
side cast,
map, that's gonna come
if,
back.
If they side cast, they're gonna have to somehow loam it, seed it, stabilize it. Right? Or I mean, they're gonna have to find a way to make sure if I don't know
side
how.
Side cast isn't a good base.
Know.
It's not a good fill to
you're,
put,
well,
you
right.
Put that
and
in
if it's not
and then put
work,
6 inches of loom on it.
Gonna
that's
work,
not gonna
but,
work.
But you know, but the bottom line is, whatever they want to do, that those banks have to be stabilized.
What happens if they're not? I mean, I guess what I'm wondering is, so they take the sand out of the bottom because, as I understand it, the water's going around a sandbar to get to the
and road in the bank.
It's creating another bend in the
and it's
undercutting trees on either side. So they
take,
want to reestablish a channel too.
Yep. No, I get that.
Okay.
So you take the sand out. And in theory, bank stops being compromised in the sense that no additional water is running against it, right?
No, well, it should increase the capacity of the stream,
yeah,
which should allow for additional flows. But every stream has its own sediment hunger, you might say, based on the speed of the water going through it. And it's going to carry whatever sediment load can be carried by the speed of the water. So it will fill back up.
And that's
all streams carry sediment.
And that's why it fills up, is because that pipe is relatively small and it slows the water.
I couldn't
down.
Even see the pipe. I don't know what that is under
that's it.
There.
No, it's
underneath.
So it's coming
off.
So the drainage area is from West Street.
Yeah.
It's has Summer Street. It has
Sand Salt, Becky, from Road on.
I can't remember all the streets, but it has pine.
What
pine
I mean
hill
is under the concrete. I don't know what
I mean,
the size or shape of the structure.
It's a 30-inch pipe.
It's got big road salt.
And
it's
comes
probably
out.
Probably a number of catch basins that contribute
tons.
To it.
That's what it's all the way from West Street and all these side streets. That's
yeah,
a huge drainage
years.
Area.
Yeah, it's just from years of it happening. And
those,
as soon as you get a.
Chuck, are those catch basins on a schedule of being cleaned out?
This area is going to settle, and that's.
As I understand it, catch basins, there's a maintenance plan just to have someone in a vac truck go to each catch
can
basin.
Can I ask a stupid question? Can you take a vac
They try to get to every one of them every
and
year.
Suck the sand.
Really?
Yeah. That's what I was told.
That's pretty good if that happens.
No, that's good. Yeah.
So it's just a small, when they do a vac truck, it's just a small load that they're sucking out.
Yeah, I mean,
right.
Well, no.
I mean, that.
Mike, isn't that 3 feet?
Was
the bottom of every catch basin? A 3 foot drop?
She's talking about the channel, vac truck.
Oh, I thought you were talking about vac truck and a.
No,
so
not
what
a
they
vac truck.
Use when they do these sediment, these sand restoration things, and they suck the sand out like Plum Island.
Are they using vacuum trucks? I don't know.
It's a jet. It's a water on a jet, and they suck it out.
So the MWRA got all that sediment out of that stream on Howard Street with a vac dirt truck.
Right. But that was wet.
Good job.
That was wet, though. That was below.
That
was a wet stream.
That would work, wouldn't it? I think a vac truck would be able to suck sand out of a stream.
I don't know if you can tell from here, but from that water level.
I think that's still
going to
be a really, really slow process.
Could be 3 feet.
No, I understand. It's a lot of sand.
And so if you can get a vac truck out there, why can't you get a dump truck out there?
They don't have that equipment. They don't have a vac truck.
Oh, because the vac truck that they used at the MWRA just kept adding and adding hose, and it wasn't even an issue.
Well, why don't you ask? It sounds like we need a little more information from engineering about what
they
plan.
Okay. So
that's
not.
So
that's not going to be something they can do. I'm going to tailor this.
So they're probably going to go in with a bobcat.
It's a small, you know,
small excavator
machine with a scoop on one end. They'll be able to basically their way of doing it is they want to
make too much money in taxes.
Take it out and dump it on the bank. Or dump it next to the stream, whichever, that's what they want to do. Whichever works out best, because they'll have one machine in there doing this.
So why can't they take that material out?
That's gonna be tough.
With a little
backhoe like that.
A little backhoe would make many trips. It'd be harder to there'd be a lot of damage with that. And if they couldn't bring another truck in there close enough. So you're probably talking about a bigger machine with a bigger reach that they'd have to get in there just to get that into a dump truck, which they would probably have to cut some trees down to.
Right.
Take care.
Back to my question. So this stream is draining into a 30-inch pipe, we think, right? And you can't see the opening to the pipe because it's all filled in. So the water's finding its way elsewhere. Is that right?
Well, it just slowly drains.
No.
So the
no, that's not right.
Filling up and then it's draining.
So that's not right. So on Warren Ave is the end of the 30-inch pipe. That's where it comes out from West Street and all these other streets and all that drainage area. And downstream is through Pinevale, cross Main Street, cross 306 Main Street, cross Perfectos, turns into Walker's Brook, splits up a little bit in its tributaries,
yeah.
Goes past the DPW garage, goes past our Lakeville Vale project, and then off into kind of where Cumberland Farms is. So,
yeah. So the 30-inch pipe that it's draining, is it draining out of the 30-inch pipe? Or
out
of the 30-inch pipe. Okay. And then it's just draining
into Pinevale, and Pinevale is very flat, and it's taking 200 feet to settle out.
So if that's draining out of that pipe, are you thinking that whole pipe is clogged?
No, I'm just thinking that that's such a drainage area. We don't even use that much sand in town anymore. I think that's such a huge drainage area that you're getting just a little bit of sediment from everywhere. And
is
in a big storm, it just flushes straight through.
Is it worse because of the West Street construction?
Backwards. I thought it was going into the pipe.
Yeah, I did too. I did too.
No.
You don't think the West Street construction has anything to do with this?
Well, it's probably made it more efficient. So...
But it's so far away.
I mean, there's so much more being added to it as it comes. All of Summer Street's in it,
yeah.
Or most of Summer Street's
okay.
in it.
All right.
Did I take my?
So it's not a question. I was under the impression that this water was running into the pipe.
Yeah.
No, it's basically daylighted after that comes out of that pipe in Warren Street. There's another pipe somewhere, but this is a 30-inch pipe.
But you couldn't see the pipe.
It's under the sand. Did you see that puddle right here?
I did.
But so if it's
did.
Under the sand,
so,
and it's,
so
the
it's
sand
under the
is
puddle,
up
and
the
it's
pipe.
Under that sand.
So it's coming up and then over
thinking.
The sand.
No, it's there's some way that there's some break underneath that sewer pipe inside this concrete wall. There's some break that allows the water from one side to convey to the other side of the concrete wall. But you can't see it. You can't.
Okay.
It's under there somewhere.
So
I don't
so
know
the,
if it's a box culvert. I don't know if it's a... this constriction.
So the realistic part of this is they've got a very small machine and they're going to have to side cast it or spread it.
They're not going to be able to get it out of there.
Actually, that's not true. Because most of those mini excavators are track machines. And you can get in with the track machine, the mini excavator, then you could take a track skid steer and take it out with the track skid steer and put it in the truck and get it rid of it.
Why are other people saying you can't do it? Which is it?
A track skid steer.
Right.
Is a big operation going from a mini to a skid steer to a dump truck.
That's how you get it out of there.
I know, but it's a big operation. What Chuck is saying, you can't hardly get in there.
But
he's saying to get a dump truck in there, you got to cut down trees.
But
ruin the bank.
Is a small operation what this is calling for? I mean, this is a problem that's just going to reoccur. If we side cast, we're just pushing it to the side so that more can come in, settle in, and we're going to sidecast that again, and we're going to sidecast that again. I mean,
my thought is if we make it a bigger operation, then they're going to balk. They're
right.
not going to do it. They're going to say,
they can't balk. This is a problem. I mean,
this is
let me see that again.
This is the access. I took a photo of the access from, this is the access from the edge of the neighborhood.
50 yards?
The path.
Oh, okay.
So it's a pretty
wide,
open path.
Doesn't have
so you
feet,
back
like
down
50
this path.
Feet long. It's 50 yards.
That's
5-10 wheeler loads.
Yeah,
I didn't
that's
it
the path.
So.
And you
probably
could
a foot, not a foot and a half.
You know, and
so
when you get close
so
to,
that's,
so
it's probably
Mike, that's enough
eight.
For 10
so you'd have to take
that.
You could
drive a truck
so
back there. Plus, if when you get
well, that's not
to, so this is the sewer manhole, and then this is the bridge for
the
stream.
Have you been out there?
There's
no.
And there's just
yeah.
little.
No, we didn't see it.
Maybe we should put it on a site visit.
Yeah, I think we're.
Chuck, so why is
picture, you get a bigger than a smaller back when you get a 230 or something, and you can back a 10-wheeler right up to it and cast right into the 10-wheeler with one piece of equipment.
Mm.
It sounds like.
And that's probably not too big of a task.
It sounds like
that.
We would just to summarize, it sounds like we're interested to know a little bit more specifics of how exactly they're going to remove that dirt and what their plan is to remove and or. How they're going to manage that sand.
Let me ask, Chuck, are you comfortable with what they're proposing, or?
I'm absolutely comfortable with what they're proposing, except I needed you guys, commission, to agree with the side casting.
Are you comfortable with the side casting?
It was done 15 years ago. They're going to clean up this project. They're not having to get in there for a long time. If there's some way to stabilize it and lock it into the bank, it's going to... I mean, this bank is undermined. So by putting it there, it's not the best material. Put it on the bank. I don't know.
What exactly is it that... Why does the DPW feel like they have to do this? What's in it for them? Like
there's flooding, isn't there?
Yeah, there's flooding, and there's that 30-inch sewer. Is that... I think it's a... 6 or 12-inch sewer line that's
kind of
causing this whole problem.
It's not something that they can bother.
So they said,
yeah,
they said this is top priority for them.
Okay.
It's either going to be an emergency and a lot bigger job, or we got to take care of it now.
Getting the material out and bringing in organic, stabilizing the banks, planting.
Can I propose another way to stabilize the bank? Can they bring in some rocks, boulders, and create a new channel? So not a real armored channel, but just put some rocks in and then side cast. So at least you get some sort of...
Use the rocks as retaining walls.
It keeps the sand from getting suspended in the water and washed back in.
So to do that, you would really need to grade... Like, you can't just put a couple cobbles and not have sand like this, so fine sand just wash back in. You would really have to grade that mixes.
You'd have to grade it, and you'd have to get the, you know, the right.
I'm just trying to think of a way to allow the side casting.
Gravel, pack, when I say grade, I mean the size of the stone. You have to do, you have to mix in a bunch of different grain sizes. It can't just be one then the other, because it's just going
to
flow right around.
Can I just flip this pancake another way? If this was a piece of private property and had someone that was discharging sand off a private property into a wetland, you'd make them get rid of it, wouldn't you?
Yeah, it would be, I only can think of if a private property owner was dumping sand into a wetland to create more usable space on his lawn, because if this happened where it's a drainage area and it's just ending up in his lawn, we would work with him.
Yeah.
So.
But this is directed, and it's something that is being placed there that wasn't part of the original topography.
Well, it's not being placed there. I mean,
it's
a drainage function.
It's draining.
Function.
Right.
I think that's.
It's a constant maintenance
right.
issue in all drainage areas in town.
Yeah.
I guess the other question: Are they doing this in other areas? And has it been okay? I guess that would be...
Our last general permit allowed them to go 15 feet out into a stream and do this. We approved it. It was approved during that. And that was a general
Temple?
Permit that went 5 years.
Okay.
Did
we don't know any place that it's ever happened. A general permit gives permission for similar jobs throughout whenever they come up.
Yep.
So they don't have to report to us. It's just allowed. But we didn't. This new general permit doesn't allow any work in a stream because we got a lot of pushback from from DEP. What I would say is, if you guys are concerned, I think the core logs are better than a hardscape. It's kind of where everyone's going these days. You could create a channel by running two rows 3 feet apart all the way down, staking them in, and that would hold back the sand on either side. you know, most people, so when you get into rocks, it's going to heat the stream, it's not good, all that. It's, I mean, you don't want to see hardscape out there.
No, I hear you. I'm just trying to think of a way to, I don't want the sand to run back
in. That would prevent, you know, something from coming in. It could be spread out. And there were opportunities to fill in, you know, an area that had been undermined and, you know, a lot of material taken away. I don't know if it's 10-yard truckloads.
The core logs with plantings, the willow plugs, they do work.
Yeah, that seems okay to me.
In sand?
Well, you're not putting them in sand. You're saying the sand's over here, and then you've got the core logs along the bank. So
where's the sand
at the base
going?
Of the bank?
The sand's going at the base of the bank or above, on top of the bank?
It's going on the top of the bank.
Okay.
So
over.
What's a core log is? You stack them, what, one or two high? What is it?
You stack them?
No, you don't have to stack them at all, but you can.
And here's our bank. Y'all want over it. And you want to fill side cast to here?
Yeah. You could stack them, I guess you could stack them too high. Yeah, I don't know if you'd stack them like that, but you could.
They kind of go, as the bank goes up.
I don't know what a core log.
A core log is just a
coconut fiber log.
A tube.
Okay.
And it decomposes within 5 to 7 years.
Yeah. It's
but if you put
five
the,
to seven.
If you
hollow?
Put,
no, it's filled
no,
with
solid.
Filled
it's
with coconut fiber.
Coconut.
Solid.
Filled with.
And it's actually is almost like a planting medium. That's
yeah.
why they put those plugs in. Then the willows spread out the roots, and then they stabilize the bank. That's what the whole thing is all about. They've been using them for a long time.
That sounds good to me.
Yeah,
I'm fine with that.
If you think that's a good idea and you're comfortable with side casting in that manner, then. I don't have.
Yeah, if you're using these logs in side casting, that's a whole huss of a different color.
Mm.
That's holding back the castings, at least.
Yeah, and I was thinking as you guys were talking, we don't have to dump it in one spot. It could be spread up and down the stream,
so
it's not so built up in certain areas, and maybe we could just achieve this area that really holds back with one,
yeah.
with one log.
One log, and that creates a little shelf that's going to vegetate. So,
my fundamental concern is just bank stability, and so if that addresses
it, sounds like this
it,
achieves
it's fine
it.
With me.
Absolutely, sounds like
well,
this
the
achieves
bank
it.
Is undermined and undercut right now, and
right.
it will fall in at some point, and there's trees up and down it, and that's just going to happen.
Right.
This is going to help stop that from happening, and
right.
you know, even in this spot, it's damp and shady. Something's going to grow, you know.
So these core logs, they are like 20-foot lengths. How do they come?
Any, they come in rolls that you could just.
They're flexible.
Like spools. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
and
they
you
roll
stake
them
in.
Out, flatten them out, and stake them in.
No. They're
not
gonna. They're
flat.
They're gonna be. It's.
They're
big.
Cylinders.
Yeah, I get it, but they come in a
tubes.
Coil.
Right.
So you uncoil them and mm-hmm. put them somewhat in a straight manner on the side of the bank and stake them in.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Correct.
Wow, I never.
It's well, if you want to see them, we used the same ones at in back of Building 7 at Johnson's Woods.
Yep.
Did I get that? Pulte Homes, which one's that? Johnson. Redding Woods.
Yeah.
One's Redding Woods, one's Johnson Woods. But
okay.
Pulte Homes site in back of Building 7, there's a channel there. 3 years ago, they did that. As it came out of the culvert, they just placed them all the way down the side and all the way around the corner to direct the stream. They're still there now.
Yeah, it sounds like so they're flex. They can they'll bend
oh, yeah.
right or left, and
yeah.
Yeah,
you can
sounds,
actually weave
sounds,
them underneath
and,
the roots and stuff.
And Ryan's okay with these? Ryan's using.
No,
them
I need to talk to him about some of the stuff.
Oh.
I'm going to find out.
Okay.
So if he's not okay with it, then you know
we're
back at the next meeting.
Yep. Okay.
I think he's okay. Kind of ending a problem, okay? So if he can get in here and maintain it, and we
would it make future maintenance easier too.
That's what the problem he's going to try to fix. I don't know if they
so
need to get back in there for 15 years though.
Roughly, Chuck, what how many feet? How many lineal feet do you
think
you need of this coral?
From one end to the other. Oh, how many lineal feet do we think we need this for?
Yeah, you do it both sides for how
right.
for how long?
One was 65. I'd say 120 feet.
Well, that's not...
Would they go upstream of the concrete?
They would only be required to put this stuff in as far as they can go. So if they, if the,
do you know what I mean,
the
though?
Bank
I mean,
comes together and they can't move that vehicle forward and they can't do any digging, then we can't ask them to restore that area.
My point is when you stand on the concrete bridge there and you look downstream, what we decided was downstream to the right, the farther distance, the 65 feet, there's a pile of sand there. But when you look upstream, there's also some chunks of sand.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not clear to me whether that's part of what they want to do as
well. They talked about both sides.
Yeah. So that would be maybe an additional 20. So it's like 65.
Well, I think it's
plus
65.
20 times 2, because it's two sides of the bank.
Right. So
when
I was
talking
to Allie, I meant 65 on both sides, just
so
to be safe. So
160,
times
2. 160 to 200 feet of quarry locks.
Yeah, I mean, that's reasonable.
And
so you'll have the conversation with him and them and report back to us at the next meeting.
I'll write the enforcement and I'll send it to the commission, so make sure the wording's right and we covered everything. I'll talk to Ryan and tell him what he'd like, and obviously our first choice is to remove that sand, that debris. And secondly, he's going to have to maintain the bank.
How much does everyone feel the same way that's based on the way the conversation went? I'm not so sure that removing that sand is our first choice.
Mm-hmm.
I think if we could stabilize the bank with these coral logs, that might be our first choice.
You have to remove
the sand. Their sand has to be.
Well, they're
going to
sidecast it. They're going to sidecast it on top of the coral logs, right? That's
no,
going to fill
on
in
on top.
On the outside of it.
Right.
But that's a substantial gap, isn't it, Chuck? From the core log to the bank, how many feet, roughly? I know it wavers, but is it 1 foot, 6 inches, 3 feet?
I would try to put it as close to the natural bank as I could.
Oh, okay. So you're not going to use a lot
of
the...
Because I'm not designing a stream.
All right.
We don't want to make this stream channel smaller.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden concentrate flow faster
so
down.
It'll be a reasonable amount. There'll be some compromises made, but it's going to be pretty wide, and it's not going to.
Okay.
I'm not going to shrink this 6 foot thing into a 2 foot channel in the center.
And the quantity
that's not going to help anybody.
The quantity that we're talking about of soil is going to fill up pretty quickly if we're putting it behind these logs as well. I mean,
it'll definitely take a big chunk out of what needs to be hauled out.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right, fine.
I don't know what the upstream looks like. It might not even be. Might be just. Maybe they're going to be satisfied with.
Yeah.
You know, doing less work.
So you're going to write an enforcement order.
Yeah.
So naturally speaking, what I expect would happen after that sand is removed is the base of that stream after the next couple of rain events. Once that sand's taken out, the base of that stream is going to. Create its own new slope based on whatever water action. So streams have a natural slope to them,
mm-hmm.
right? So after all that sand is taken out, there's going to be a lot of re-equilibration in that channel system. It's just my point.
So I've had to in the past actually take a pebble count, a stream count, stones in a stream before I replicate and cross it, and then.
Well, that's for a crossing. That's
replicate
an extreme crossing standard.
Yeah, replicate it with a pebble count so that.
It's the same thing.
We can't do a pebble count.
Because there's nothing to count. It's
to come
with sand. I know, but could we get some sort of.
We have no idea what it looks like. It's covered in sand, and
well,
when a sand piles up over here, it undermines
like.
The bank on that side.
We know what an average stream looks like. Putting an average stream bed in there with some pebbles or some stones, Anika, wouldn't that...
What's that called?
The point is that
wouldn't
a stream
slow
is a
the
dynamic...
Have to do that
the point is a stream is a dynamic system.
You
so it's
going like
to be constantly responding to
have
water,
to the volume of water
flowing
going
through
down
there. And the sediment load carried by that water.
So whatever that sediment load is.
It's just going to constantly readjust.
Whatever
right.
that sediment
that.
Load is, wouldn't it be decreased with a proper stream bottom with stones in it?
No.
No.
No, the sediment load is the sediment load determined by what's coming into the channel from upstream.
What you want to do.
Okay.
If you're
on the velocity of that water and the volume of that water.
If you want to really create something that's going to help you out here in this situation, basically you want to turn whatever just in after that 30-inch culvert at Warren, when it comes out of there, you want to make a detention basin for everything to settle out and a spillway. And that's going to be where all the maintenance happens, and everything else downstream is going to be clean.
But that's what we have right now. That's the condition that we
have. Yeah, that's what we have right now with that sewer main going across because it's blocked up and it's acting as a dam.
I mean, that's what...
That's what I'm dealing with is constructed wetlands with just that forebay, and that forebay, if it's cleaned on a regular basis, is only a few wheelbarrows of silt. And then after it goes through the forebay, it goes through the constructed wetlands, and it's almost silt-free. So if you stay on that forebay, then the constructed wetlands is... I've done
but
that,
we're not
you know,
constructing
six times.
A retention-detention basin here. We're just removing... They're just removing
the
sand.
We could construct a forebay.
But we're getting into well beyond what we need to do. This is just where they're saying that this is going to be a problem. This is sand in a stream. It's a violation. It needs to be removed. So that's where the enforcement order comes in. We can put some conditions on it, but if we get into stream bank construction, I mean, we can do some things like we're doing with the core logs and all that, but if we get into redoing the bank and all that, it should be... And notice of intent.
We might need the Army Corps by the time we're done.
I think so. Can we move on, please?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was way too much on that.
Yes.
Do we need to vote on an enforcement order?
Yes.
Think.
Yeah.
Is your...
I thought you made a motion.
Did I make a motion?
You did. And...
Okay. If I made a motion...
And then I asked about sand. How the sand was going to be dealt with. And then we took a left turn. So I will second his motion.
All those in favor? Okay. And last but not least, did we get minutes?
No. My apologies. My bad.
Yeah, you are.
We'll see him tomorrow.
Okay. All right.
2 cents tomorrow. How about that?
All right. I think any other items?
No, only one set. I'm doing this meeting.
Okay.
I can have your notes, or you can modify my notes with your notes. But we're gonna get at least a draft out.
Gotcha. What about
Bill's
Lakeville?
No emergency permit.
None.
Oh. Just trying to make sure you hammer it at the right time. That's all. Trying to be helpful.
What?
Quickly.
Lakeville? Waste? Trash?
Right. We have a kind of a letter.
Right. David Panette, you had a question about it?
Whether this was just going to be brought up in open meeting.
What is it?
The enforcement order to clean up the trash that is spilling over into the 115 Lakeview. Property that we went out to last week.
So we looked at Lakeview, and I had walked around the corner, and there's a dumpster there at the corner of the apartments, and I think it's 1 through 15 Lakeview Ave. So there's apartments there, and they go all the way out to Walker's Brook. In the corner by our project, next to Walker's Brook, there is a dumpster. The chain link fence. All around the chain link fence is, you know, regular household trash, Class A trash. And it needs to be picked up because it'll only get worse. And I contacted the health department, and we went out there together, and I wrote this letter and sent it to the owner. And he wrote a letter to the owner also, because on the second visit, we noticed that. There was no dumpster lids on those dumpsters, which is a requirement here in town. So hopefully we get some results, but I haven't heard from them.
That's not the Lakeview that we're...
No, this is the apartment
building. The existing apartment building.
Yeah, so I didn't enter their property. I was standing on our site visit route and looking.
Okay.
So we're just waiting to hear back from a response from the owner?
Yeah, and the amount of trash out there is probably half an hour's worth of work or 20 minutes worth of work for their landscape guy when he comes there. And there's even a hole in the fence so we can get to it. So it doesn't seem to be worth even worrying about if I was the owner of that place. I hope it goes that well.
Okay.
All right. Time will tell.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second. Anybody second it?
Third.
Second.
Adjourn. Thank you, everyone.
Hi. Everything.